Hi, and welcome to my talk on Design for Testing. This is Compute 301. I'm Abram Hindle from the Department of Computing Science at the University of Alberta. You can reach me at abram.hindle@ualberta.ca, and here's my webpage, Software Processes. So, we want to design for testing. So, first off, we want to think about what is good software design relevant to testing. Essentially, we want software to be flexible, and this means it should be easy to change, and it should be able to respond to new needs via change. It should be easy to understand, and because it's easy to change and easy to understand, it should be easy to extend without exploding in complexity. So it shouldn't take us rewriting all of the code to add a feature. It should only require interacting with a small API. So flexible software oftentimes is testable software, because testable software is software that is easy to construct into units, that is easy to set up units into desired state, that is, it's easy to instantiate a component and be able to get it up to a point where you can test it without a ton of work, and it's easy to drive code and observe it change the world. Change the software program so you can actually see what the values turn out to be. Here's an example of a bad design. We've got a photo album server. The photo album server has the following responsibilities. It processes requests, it parses user preferences, it applies image transformations, and assembles images into albums, and it delivers these results to users. So it's a big class with a lot of responsibilities. A lot of responsibilities should already pique your ears, and you should think, gee, those responsibilities should be separate classes and be the responsibility of separate objects and encapsulate state. Exactly. So that design shows poor flexibility. It's difficult to extract and reuse parts. They're all methods, if we're lucky, in one class. It's complex to add new features. We have to change methods in this one class. And the instance variables tend to be global. So if this one class is responsible for everything, then probably we have one object which is responsible for anything, because it's unlikely that we'll have multiple photo album servers. Furthermore, it has poor testability. Only basically end-to-end testing is possible. So one task in and out, that's about it. We can't really test the sub-methods very easily. Furthermore, for this to work, we'll need a results file for every combination of preference settings and image transformations. So if it reads in a user preferences file, we'll need a user preferences file before we can make an instance of this server. So we can improve this design by addressing the separate concerns that exists within this class. So if we go look, we can see request, preferences, image transformations, albums, delivery. So we could have things like a request handler that accepts requests. We could read the user preferences. We could parse them. We could have an image effect class. We could have user preferences even as a class. We could have an image transformer class. So this new design, where we've broken out the photo album server into multiple classes, it has better flexibility, it uses OO design, it's easier to understand, and it's got smaller, easier to separate parts, and that means that we can actually test the parts. This is because we can focus the tests on each unit, we can write test fixtures easier to provide we can test the fixtures easier to provide for each unit. We can also check the results better. So it means that we usually don't need the whole application to work, just test a small part of it. It's easier to provide test cases as well as test utilities to test each unit. So we should consider forming dependencies. So look at this code here. We've got public class example service, private data source, the data source. We've got example service, the data source equals new data source. And then when we execute the service, we get the info. So we basically have an example service aggregated by one data source. So we've got this class depending on one data source. And you'll notice this data source gets built here. Okay. Consider if we want to test the example service with a different data source. Well, one method that we could do would be dependency injection. So if you look at this method, it doesn't take the data source as an argument. This method, called dependency injection, if you look at this constructor, does take a data source and assigns the data source. So basically, when we call do service, it delegates to that data source. This means that we can make a fake data source, or we can inject a test data source instead of a real one, which means that when we test, we can execute different parts of this code because we have full control over this data source. So consider making a cell phone. So we've got chipsets for the communications. We've got an antenna, and this forms a GSM radio. We've got a keypad, and we've got ourselves a cell phone. So here's a system assembly without dependency injection. We've got a cell phone. We've got a radio that we initialize here. Radio equals new GSM radio. We've got an input device. Input device equals new keypad. Our radio, right, which we're making here, has two parts, two components, and it goes chipset equals new Qualcomm chipset, antenna equals new Fractus quad band antenna. And then we can see here that we just make a new cell phone. It's fully assembled. But what if we want to test this cell phone? What if we want to say, what happens when the radio fails? Well, how do we put in a new test radio? So basically, it has poor flexibility. It's difficult to change and plug in parts. Different radios, different antennas, fake radios, fake parts, those are all hard. Furthermore, the testability is hampered because we can't supply test versions of parts. We can't go, okay, use a fake GSM radio or use a fake keypad where we can send our own keypad commands. Because basically the entire aggregate is fully constructed. And to redo this, we'd have to redo a lot of work. We'd have to rebuild a lot of things. So it's very expensive. And that's without dependency injection. Now I want you to think about this for a sec. How would we add dependency injection to this? So how would we add dependency injection to these classes? Let's go look at our old example, dependency injection. This is without dependency injection. This is with dependency injection. All right. So this is without dependency injection. What are we going to change for dependency injection? Well, we're going to add constructors with parameters. Here we specify the radio. This radio equals radio. This input device equals input device. We allow the developer to specify these components. The same for the GSM. Basically, this is like an inside-out object. We're giving it its parts, and it's constructing an object with its parts. So to make a new cell phone, we basically have to go new cell phone with a new GSM radio that has a GSM chipset and that has this antenna. It basically makes the dependency resolution inside-out. And it means that we can make a cell phone of any configuration, and we can put fake parts in that allow us to test the behavior of the cell phone. If you think this is too much, you can always leave this code around, and these default constructors will basically set up the cell phone with these options as default. By having this dependency injection, it means you have it more flexible, so the rest of the cell phone can technically be tested. because you added this dependency injection. So the UML of what it looks like is this. We've got the radio, and it's composed by the chipset and the antenna. The radio composes the cell phone, so does the input device. Furthermore, I want you to look at the difference here. We say radio, chipset, antenna, input device, cell phone. Well, it could be a GSM radio. It could be a Qualcomm GSM chipset. It could be a Fractus quad band antenna. It can be an input device. We're no longer bound. We are no longer bound by the original implementations. Instead of coding to implementation, we now code to specification. We now code to the interface. We are now coding through the interface instead of the exact implementations like keypad or Fractus quad band antenna. So we basically assemble from the bottom up. We make our chipset and we make our antenna, then we make our GSM radio, then we make our keypad, then we make our cell phone. So let's go back to the original example. So we discussed dependency injection here for the cell phone, but let's think about that original example of bad design with the photo album server. So it's got too many things. Now we want to break out these responsibilities in the classes. Okay? And the classes are right here. So we have request handler, user preferences, things like that. And user preferences can come from a file, which could be pretty annoying, because if we wanted to test it, it would mean that our test suite would need a file. So here we've got the class user. It takes a file. It parses the file. It does something. And here's what parse file does. It reads the file in and returns the preferences. But we see that really, we don't store a file here. We don't even store this file name. We don't care. All we care about is what's inside of that file. So how would we add dependency injection to the user class in this case? So dependency injection, usually we do it in this constructor, which allows us to set values. Which value would we set? We wouldn't set file, we'd probably set preferences. This design at the moment, it suffers from requiring a file to really test it, and the users all need their preferences, and it's difficult to reuse user because you need that preference file. It's hard to test because you have to make a user file, and making files on disk is slow, or you need a test file to test that combination. So the dependency injection version of user allows you to inject the preferences directly. This doesn't stop you from leaving this constructor around. This constructor sets the preferences and allows you to inject your own preferences and have like a sample test preferences that you could inject right into there. This design, which is the dependency injection of that, is a better design because we don't really care if the user file format changes. The preferences don't have to be made from files. Note, we can also move this parse file out. We can put it in a different class. We can use it in user preferences parser. And then we could just delegate to the user preferences parser right here instead of requiring the method to be in the class. This is better testable because we can run our tests fast. Now, one of the reasons you run tests is to get feedback about if your system works or not. It's best if this feedback is immediate and quick. If it takes many minutes, you're not going to run the tests as much. If it takes seconds, you'll run tests quite often. Furthermore, this new design allows us to inject fake or mock objects. Mock objects are basically fake objects that will react in certain ways that allow you to test them. So you could maybe make like a user preferences that reports every single time it's accessed, and you could make a test that makes sure that the preferences are accessed. You could make a mock user preferences that is buggy and doesn't act appropriately or has the wrong preferences in it, and you could test to see how well the user class deals with awkward preferences. So here's a mock object, or we're going to use a mock object. We've got public class user test. We're going to write a test, and it's called test do something. And here we got mock preferences extends preferences, but is overridden with canned settings. No test preference files needed. So we make mock preferences. Then we instantiate a user with the mock preferences. Then we say user do something, and then we make sure we have this method here in mock preferences to make sure that the preferences did not change. So our mock preferences object will basically keep track of any possible changes it made. If we don't expect this to change the preferences, then this should work. It should be true. So we made a mock object here, a fake one. What we would have to do is we'd have to make a mock preferences class, and it would have to act according to the preferences interface. So by specifying an interface, we can inject mock objects and alternative implementations. So consider this bad design. Many pieces of information are needed by classes throughout the system, but each class just needs a one or a few items. And how can we provide this information to the consumers of that data? So you've got like configuration information, you've got many other kinds of information, like say your database information, maybe your user preferences, fonts. How do you provide that to the consumer? So consider that. Well, typical solutions allow the consumers to get the data as they need. You can make the data global, you can pass around a context object, you can make the data, you can put the data into like statics in a widely known class and use classes. So here's an example. We've got the public class account, right? Account takes user. And what it wants to do is it wants to get the country from user. And it does so by getting the user's preferences, gets their location, and then gets their country. I want you to think right now, what's the problem with this line? What looks possibly negative about this line? What are the bad qualities about this line? Well, count the number of dots. 1, 2, 3. How many method calls do we have here? 1, 2, 3. There are actually three spots where we could get a null pointer or a null reference exception. The user could be null, their get preferences could be null, the location from the get preferences could be null. All of those could be an issue. This design has poor flexibility because the method parameters do not show what the method really needs. What does this method want? It wants the country, right? It wants the country. But what does it ask for? The user. When you do this kind of code walk, you basically enforce an API and enforce that preferences has to have location, location has to have country. Whereas if you simply provide country, then you don't have to worry about maintaining this chain in your code. This is relatively complicated. This is a lot of delegation. It basically locks in the structure. The reason why it's hard to test is because to test this with mock objects, you'd need to make a mock user or use a real user, inject the preferences. You'd need to inject preferences, and this preference would have to have the right location. And that location in the preference would have to have the right country. That means that you probably need two or three fake or mock classes, which means that testing this is very expensive. So here's another example. We've got public void test something for account. We set up the test. We go country equals new country Canada. We got location equals new location, and we set the country. Then we make a preferences object, and we set the location. Then we make a user object, and we set the preferences. Then we finally make the new account. Look at how many lines of code we need just to make a new account. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And then all that account cares about is this final country. Can't we do this in two lines? Well, we can. We can go country equals new country, and we can go account equals new account. We can refactor. We can add an account dependency injection constructor that allows us to just inject the country rather than providing the user. This means that it's far easier to test, and also in the future it's far more flexible because we're declaring the information that we want. If we always get that information that way, we can still pass it in that way, but we don't have to rely on that structure always existing. Alright? So, we were reviewing dependency injection. Dependency injection is about allowing you to inject things like mock objects, like this mock preferences. It's about allowing you to inject that into an object by say, setting up constructor parameters that allow you to inject it, or other setters that allow you to inject it. By having the dependency injection, you increase your flexibility because you allow mock objects to be inserted, and you increase testability because you don't require the entire system to exist. Furthermore, dependency injection promotes programming to interfaces rather than implementation. For dependency injection mock objects to work, you need these interfaces such that you can pass in a mock object that has a compatible interface to that object itself. Furthermore, by coding to the specification rather than the implementation, you make your code a lot more flexible, and you can inject things for testing or for other purposes. A good reason you might do dependency injection is because some cases are hard to reach. With mock objects, what's really nice about them is that you could make mock objects that will induce certain errors. Imagine you made, in this cell phone example, a GSM chipset that was randomly buggy, or a GSM chipset that would fail after four accesses. Then you could test code in your cell phone or your GSM radio that would check error situations. It would allow you to check error receiving code, and that would ensure that you had coverage on that code. So we have dependency injection, and dependency injection allows us to insert mock objects, which allow us to test more things to be sure about the behavior of the system. Alright, so in the next video I'm going to cover test-driven development.